And welcome to the sixth meeting of the Health and Sport Committee in 2021. We have received apologies from Alex Cole-Hamilton. Can I ask all members and witnesses please to ensure that mobile phones are on silent and all other notifications are turned off during our meeting. The first item on our agenda is subordinate legislation. We have two statutory instruments before us which have been laid before the Scottish Parliament and before both Houses of Parliament at Westminster by the Privy Council. These instruments are subject to the negative procedure. The first instrument we have in front of us today is the General Pharmaceutical Council Coronavirus Amendment Rules Order of Council 2021, an order of the Privy Council which approves rules made by the General Pharmaceutical Council and comes into force on the 4th of March 2021. Do any members have any comments on this order? If not, can I ask, are we agreed to make no recommendations on this order? We are so agreed. Thank you very much. The second instrument we will consider is the Health and Care Professions Council Coronavirus Amendments Rules, Order of Council 21. Again, an order of the Privy Council approving rules made by the Health and Care Professions Council due to come into force on the 4th of March. This instrument was drawn to our attention by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, which wrote to the Scottish Government highlighting what appeared to be an error in the drafting of the schedule to the order. The Scottish Government has acknowledged that error and confirmed that the UK Government will bring forward a new order in Council to correct the position ahead of the instrument coming into force. That was welcomed by the DPLR committee and therefore, while the instrument we're considering today has not been withdrawn, it will be superseded by a new order. Are there any members who wish to make any comments in relation to this order? If not, is the committee agreed to make no recommendations? That is agreed. Thank you very much. That concludes consideration of these instruments. We now move to agenda item 2, which is consideration of the Scottish Government's budget 2021 to 2022. This is a continuation of evidence we started at last week's meeting, and so I welcome back to the committee Dean Freeman, Cabinet Secretary for Health and Sport, and Richard McCallum, Interim Director of Health, Finance and Governance, Scottish Government. Thank you for joining us again today. Everyone will know our pre-budget report was published last November in order to provide the government with time to consider our recommendations ahead of its forthcoming budget. And the government's response to our report was received on Monday, the 8th of February, 2021. And we have therefore had the opportunity to consider it further. And we will now move directly to questions. Can I ask, first of all, Cabinet Secretary, when boards will be notified of any further COVID-related funding for the current financial year, and when will COVID funding for 2021 to 22 be allocated to NHS boards? Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to you and colleagues. Mr. McCallum can, I'm sure, deal with the current position in terms of the future position. Boards are currently working through their mobilisation plans. I think this would be the third iteration of their mobilisation plans as we look to come through the pandemic, considering how they intend to deal with the backlog of non-COVID healthcare that has inevitably accumulated in response to the pandemic, but how also they intend to do that across the whole of the healthcare sector, so therefore including primary care, but also working with their partners in social care, and taking account of the current pressures on the workforce and the consequences of those pressures. Staff have been working at considerable pressure and pace for about 11 months now, and therefore we need to factor that into the planning which will come through in those mobilisation plans. Our expectation, we've asked boards to have those plans with us by the end of this month. That will give us an indication of what they intend, and obviously we'll be discussing that with them, what the financial resourcing is for that, and where there are additional continuing COVID pressures that they need to meet. Obviously, some of the COVID pressures that are national that will follow through into the next financial year, covering PPE, for example, testing, vaccination programme, are dealt with nationally. But there will be additional pressures, I'm sure, that boards will want to highlight to us as continuing. And we'll factor all of that in and then have discussions with them and their finance directors about the additional COVID requirement they have over and above what is currently in the draft budget. In terms of the current financial year, I know that Mr. McCallum has led detailed discussions with boards following the distribution of the first tranche of money to meet their COVID pressures. And I think he can now give you an update on where we are at this point.
Richard McCallum.
Yeah, so as the Cabinet Secretary says, we've allocated two significant tranches of funding. The first allocation was at the end of September of $1.1 billion, and we followed that up just over a week ago with a further $600 million for health boards and IJV. So funding has been allocated out now to boards, and we would largely expect that that will be the full additional requirement for COVID costs in 2020-21. There may be some additional costs still to come through, particularly in relation to some of those very live programmes of work at the moment, in particular vaccinations, but also potentially around test and protect as well. And there are a couple of other opportunities that we have before the year end, at the start of March and at the start of April, to make any final allocation adjustments. But I think they would be much smaller in value, and certainly not on the billions that we're talking about that have already been allocated.
Thank you very much. Can I also ask about additional funding for the running of COVID hubs by GPs? I wonder if it's possible to identify what figures are involved in that funding, and over and above the bank holiday working costs, which we have seen, but we haven't seen other figures or any offset from the cessation of some services from GP clinics during the pandemic. I wonder if Richard McCallum was able to help on that front.
Yeah, so we've allocated, and we have a breakdown of the full $1.7 billion, and we've allocated additional $77.7 million out to primary care over the course of 2020-21, and that includes costs for community hubs as well as some other additional costs as well. So there has been additional funding specifically for community hubs that's contained within that 77.7 that's been allocated, and as I say, that's funding that's been additional as part of our COVID response.
Thank you very much. It would be helpful to the committee if we were able to see that in a little more detail. That's feasible. Mr. McCallum, thank you very much. And I now call on David Stewart.
Good morning. Thank you, Convener, and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and to Mr. McCallum. How does the Scottish Government plan to use the initial allocation of $869 million in COVID-related funding for 2021-22?
Cabinet Secretary.
There are a number of carry-on pressures, if you like, around certainly the vaccination programme and test and protect. But in terms of, and also, of course, PPE, in terms of the additional detail around that, I think Mr. McCallum is able to give that to you.
Richard McCallum.
Yeah, so I think it in many ways links with the first question. We are going to be undertaking a detailed review with boards through their remobilisation plans once they're received at the end of February, and we'll be doing that over the course of March. As the Cabinet Secretary has already indicated, a significant amount of those costs will be associated with our vaccinations, test and protect and PPE programmes. But we will also be using some of that funding to continue with the remobilisation of the NHS. And obviously that's very much dependent on how the pandemic continues and in what form. But there will be funding specifically to support those remobilisation plans that health boards will have. I think that the further detail of that will become more clear once we've gone through that detailed assessment with the health boards.
David Stewart.
Thank you. The UK government has kept 21 billion reserve for the pandemic. Are you expecting funding from this source, and have you made contingency plans for this extra funding?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I wonder if Mr. Stewart could say a little bit more so I'm clearer on his question.
Certainly, Cabinet Secretary, you may have missed it in my initial question. The UK government has kept a contingency fund of £21 billion in reserve for COVID-related expenditure. In your discussions with the UK government, has there been any hint that the Scottish government will receive some of this funding? And if that is the case, have you made contingency plans upon any subsequent spend from that source of funds?
Right. Thank you. That's very helpful. Of course, my colleague Ms. Forbes continues her regular discussions with the UK government on these matters and on other areas where we have spent more than the consequentials permitted or afforded in other areas other than health. There are a number of other areas and other portfolios where there are pressures as a result of COVID, and she pursues that, of course, with the UK government. In terms of health, we know that all the health consequentials so far have come to health, and we've used them as we've already described and as I hope is set out in the letter. In terms of the convener's earlier ask around the COVID hubs and a bit more detail on the basis of the answer Mr. McCallum gave, I should just say, for the record, we're very happy to provide that. In terms of Mr. Stewart's question, if there's more Mr. McCallum has to add, then perhaps we could go to him, convener.
Richard McCallum.
I think just one thing I would add would be to highlight the spring statement that the UK government will be bringing on the 3rd of March, and I think and until that point we won't have that full clarity of how that £21 billion will be used and whether there'll be consequentials that flow from that. So clearly, this is a moving picture and one that's moved over the course of this year in terms of funding. And will likely continue to be some uncertainty in terms of funding over the course of the next few months. So I think the question about contingency, well, we should know more on the 3rd of March, and that will then obviously help inform the discussions that we have with health boards. But clearly we have to balance up all of the decisions we make by the funding certainty we have and to make some reasonable assessments of the funding that's likely to still materialise as well.
Thank you. My final question, convener, is perhaps the Cabinet Secretary can confirm, am I correct in assuming that the NRAC, the resource allocation formula, is not used entirely to allocate COVID funding to individual boards? If that is correct, what yardstick do you use then, Cabinet Secretary, to allocate funds on COVID to individual boards?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, that is correct in part. Mr. McCallum can explain more detail. In some instances, it has been more of a hybrid model in terms of the NRAC spend, the NRAC formula against additional spend where a board has spent more than what the formula would give them, then that additional amount is then also given. Because we recognise that the impact of the pandemic has not been the same across all our health boards, as would be evident from simply where how cases and the prevalence of the virus is distributed around Scotland. All boards have had pressures, without doubt. All boards are contributing to the vaccination programme, the test and protect programme. Of course, all boards have PPE needs, but on the specific response to pandemic pressures in terms of case numbers and the associated costs with all of that, there is a difference between different boards. The detail of how that is then worked through between ourselves and individual boards, I think Mr. McCallum could take the member through that.
Richard McCallum.
Yeah, so I would agree with all of those points. Where it has been obvious and where there has been clear comparable need across all boards, then we have put funding out on a formula basis. But clearly NRAC was developed before COVID and takes no account of COVID-related pressures that might emerge. So we've had to take a different approach this year in very much in the scrutiny that we've done. So, in terms of board returns, we've had detailed returns received by health boards each month. That's required scrutiny by me and my team in terms of the costs that are associated. Some of it is in relation to where the pandemic has been most acutely felt. Some of it, there's been additional costs because of rurality and some of the additional pressures that have emerged as a result of that. But there's been we have had to undertake a very detailed exercise to work through all of those things. And I suppose one thing I would just add, we have worked closely in partnership with the health boards as well. So within each of the three regions, the North, the East and the West, as well as the national boards, they have undertaken their own peer review of costs as well, comparing each other's boards to understand differences. And I think that's helped us to ensure that there's been transparency and consistency as well in approach. So that's how we've moved through it in this financial year.
Thank you very much. And I now call Sandra White.
Thank you very much, Convener. And good morning, Cabinet Secretary and Mr. McCallum. Can I just start off by asking, in terms of allocating COVID-19 funds, what lessons have been learned through the course of the pandemic so far, and how is this influencing funding decisions both in 2021, 2022 and beyond, and in particular, the passing of funding to social care?
Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks very much. There's probably three points I want to make. The first of those concerns, the formula, the NRAC formula. We touched on this last week about the formula and whether or not there was a case to review it. I was clear that I did think there was a case to review the formula as such. And what it is comprised of, that is inevitably a relatively lengthy exercise and would be for post-May. But in the meantime, I think we also have, as Mr. McCallum's just highlighted, and I also said, recognised that where there are specific additional costs as a consequence of an event, in this case, the pandemic, there is a need to be more flexible in our funding approach and our allocation approach. And in this instance, we've adopted what I would describe as that hybrid model. That degree of flexibility, how that plays out in future allocations of finances to health boards in non-pandemic situations will, I'm sure, be considered as we go forward. The second point, I think, is the importance of remembering the criticality of shifting the balance of spend. For example, we've already had mention of COVID hubs. COVID hubs were introduced as a direct response to the pandemic in order to provide a community-based route to healthcare and support that maintained the GP practice, that primary care practice, as COVID-free as best we could. That flexible approach to considering what are primary care needs then and how does that work, you can see to an extent replicated in the redesign of urgent care that is in its very early stages, but nonetheless underway through the flow centres, as they're called. Again, a triage model and trying to ensure that people get to the right care in the right place, using much more of our primary care resource including community pharmacy, which has increased significantly in the role that it plays, with more for it to do, but also optometry and dentistry. So the shifting of the balance of care applies, of course, to the resourcing, but it also applies to a wider recognition that community and primary-based care exists in addition to GP practice. And the third area, I think, is the importance of seeing health and social care funding in the round, so that we recognise that the resourcing going into social care can have an impact on the demand in healthcare, but equally the process of flow through healthcare has an impact back on social care and the demand around social care. All of that, I think, will feed into a future government's response in the round to, for example, the Feely report. But it's also a feature of our current considerations that we make, as members know, on a regular basis around the state of the pandemic and the measures, the public health measures necessary to restrict the transmission and the spread of the virus. And we talk about non-COVID health harms, but non-COVID health harms are serious and are significant, and the mobilisation plans that boards are currently working their way through finalising before they bring them into us look specifically at what needs to be done to reduce the scale of non-COVID health harms that have inevitably and unavoidably been created in responding to the pandemic. So I'm thinking, and there is a direct link across there with social care. So for example, if someone has been delayed having their hip operation, their dependence on social care support will have increased because they are less able, they're less mobile for a longer period of time than if we'd been able to deliver that planned procedure in the way that we would have done pre-pandemic.
Sandra White.
Thank you. Just a small follow-up to that one, the Cabinet Secretary. I know we have the debate this afternoon, and obviously various other areas will be covered as well. I note in November 2020 and guidance which is issued in December 2020, it was talking about continuing, the Scottish Government continues to work with stakeholders to determine the support for the social care sector. I just wonder, Cabinet Secretary, is that work still ongoing, the talks between the various groups, the stakeholders, and would this have a direct effect on the outcome of funding going to social care, you know, in the future 2021?
So the Mobilisation Recovery Group, which I chair and has been in place for some time, represents health and social care in terms of its membership. And represents two key stakeholders in social care. So Scottish Care is a member of that group. So too is COSLA in the form of Councillor Curry, who is their health and social care lead. Allied professionals are there, along with the Royal Academies, the BMA, RCN, trade unions, boards, and others. And the objective of that is, those mobilisation plans that I talked about earlier, The broad discussion around them will come back to a future Mobilisation Recovery Group meeting, as will how we are, the winter plans for health and social care were discussed through that group as well. So they have a deliberately so an overview of health and social care, so they can make sure that when we are making decisions, we continue to take it as an approach that is an overview, recognising the interdependencies between those two parts of health and social care sector. The Feely report and its recommendations to a degree takes that one step further in saying that there is more that needs to be done to ensure that where the gaps in implementation of our legislation that underpins health and social care integration, that those gaps are filled. And of course, as you said, there is a debate in Parliament this afternoon, but the delivery on the Feely report and the recommendations that are to be delivered on will of course be properly a future government post the May election.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary, for that very full response. You mentioned community hubs, and I was quite surprised in regards to the workload and output of GPs, which is not measured, and the Scottish Government doesn't hold data on the GP throughput or activity, basically. So I was quite concerned in regards to that. And really, you know, what plans does the Scottish Government have for continued use of community hubs, if they are going to continue at all? And wouldn't the data which GPs hold and the Scottish Government doesn't appear to have access to, would that not be helpful if we were continuing with the community hubs?
Cabinet Secretary.
So Ms White is absolutely right. Data here is absolutely critical, but members will recall it is a long-standing issue in terms of retrieving data from essentially independent contractors, which is what our GPs are. It is part of the GP contract to resolve this issue and have the production of regular data. That inevitably, the whole progress on essentially phase two of the GP contract has been slowed in consequence of the pandemic. But the other side of that has been unfortunate. But the other side of that is that GPs increasingly, and BMA GPs, increasingly recognise that the absence of that data means that when we look at pressures on our health service, GP practices in primary care are less visible to us in the form of data. So I can tell you what the pressure is, board by board, hospital by hospital, on beds, on ICU, on other areas of secondary and tertiary activity, because I have the data. That is less clear cut in terms of primary care. In its wider sense, it includes community pharmacy too. So the work is underway with our colleagues in the BMA and the Royal College of General Practitioners, and picking up now to ensure that we resolve those data issues so that we have an agreement on what is the data that should come in to Scottish Government, so we can understand the system as a whole on the basis of quality information, and use that then to identify pressures, gaps and plan services. In the meantime, we work with those stakeholders really closely to look at the future value of community hubs. I think they have a significant value. I think they proved themselves in response to the pandemic, undoubtedly so. They proved popular and useful to patients and to those practitioners who worked in them. And so our primary care team is now actively looking at in what way can a community hub add value to community-based care without duplicating what properly would go on in a GP practice.
Thank you for that explanation, Cabinet Secretary. I am concerned that it seems to be historical that the GPs, as private businesses, obviously have not been able to share that, and I just wonder if it would need legislation to go forward. But I'll leave that there at the moment. My next question would be, have any efficiencies been identified as a result of new ways working through the pandemic, and can savings be quantified? And I know that last week you did mention about obviously using technology more. So is there any other efficiencies which can be identified which has been helpful during the pandemic?
Cabinet Secretary.
So in terms of savings, it is a bit early because we're still in the middle of the pandemic to particularly identify or quantify savings that have come as a consequence of new ways of working that we would want to maintain. We've touched on community hubs. We spoke last week about increased use of digital technology, which is a saving in time, actually, for many patients, without completely doing away with face-to-face consultation, where that is the right thing to do and where that is what the patient wants. In terms of other savings, there will be there may be more that Ms. McCallum wants to say on this, but that work will be underway to look at what improvements in service delivery have we seen as a consequence of the pandemic that we would want to retain, and in what way do we think that increases productivity or decreases costs that would then produce savings that can be used in other ways inside the health and social care system. But the detail of that, I think the plan, the detail of it and the planning forward is work that is underway at this point. But Mr. McCallum may want to say more about that.
Richard McCallum.
Just a couple of points I would add. So I absolutely agree that that work is underway, and we won't be able to quantify potentially those levels of savings until we have a bit more certainty on those things. I think the points that you've raised, Ms. White, about digital, I think there's real opportunities there, and we've already seen that, and I think we'll continue to see that over the coming months. The other two that I would just flag, I think the redesign of urgent care, it's not just about a money saving, but I think a real benefit to patients and the population. And I think one thing that we are doing as well is working closely with our national board. So working with NSS in particular, NSS has always had the national procurement function, but has taken on even more responsibility through this pandemic. And in fact, the work that they've done has generated more in terms of investment in Scottish businesses as well. So I think there's a picture about seeing the opportunities that there might be through boards, particularly NSS, and also the work of NHS 24. So how can NHS 24 and the Scottish Ambulance Service help some of the pressures that maybe some of the territorial boards are seeing? And redesign of urgent care is one example of that, but there are other opportunities that certainly the Ambulance Service and NHS 24 are exploring as well.
Thank you. My final question, convener, will the Scottish Government commit to providing more timely information on the allocation of any additional COVID-related funding in 2021-22 to support parliamentary scrutiny?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yes, we will. We believe we have done that in the current financial year. As Mr. McCallum said, it hasn't always been straightforward to understand from the Treasury exactly what the consequentials are and what they relate to. So that in itself, those discussions take some time. But as soon as we are clear about the consequentials that come to health and how we intend to allocate those, then of course we will do everything we can to ensure that information is provided in a timely fashion.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. I now call
Donald Cameron.
Thank you and good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and Mr. McCallum. I'd like to return, if I may, to the questions I was asking last week on the NHS board budget. A couple of specific ones to start with. Why are NHS Highland and NHS Orkney receiving higher uplifts than other territorial boards?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Mr. McCallum will respond to that.
Richard McCallum.
So it's a very specific reason. We've committed to ensure that all boards are within 1% of NRAP parity. And in fact, all boards are at 0.8% as a minimum from NRAP parity this year. But actually, the NRAP formula moved in 2020-21, which pushed NHS Orkney and NHS Highland further from parity. So essentially, that additional funding that we've provided, which I think is 16 million for Highland and just under 2 million for Orkney, is to ensure that those boards remain within the NRAP position that we've set out.
Thank you very much. Donald Campbell.
Thank you for that. On the non-territorial boards, can you explain why Healthcare Improvement Scotland and NHS National Services Scotland are receiving higher uplifts than the other national non-territorial boards?
Richard McCallum.
So again, it's a different factor, but essentially what we have done is there is funding that national boards receive in year from the Scottish Government, And what we've done in 2021-22 is essentially baseline some of that funding that NSS, and in fact, I think NES as well as Healthcare Improvement Scotland are receiving. So in a sense, as beyond their core uplift, they've also received on a recurring basis some of that in-year funding that we provide. I can give a little bit more detail on the specifics of that to the committee, but that's the reason for that difference for the national boards.
Thank you very much. Donald Cumberland.
Can I turn to the issue of the escalation framework? There are various boards that are at stage 3 or 4 of that framework. And I just wondered what timescales does the government expect those boards who are at stage 3 or 4 to be de-escalated, and have those timescales been affected by the pandemic?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the framework itself has been paused in response to the pandemic. Just so we're clear, NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde, Tayside, Highland and Borders are currently at stage 4 on the performance escalation framework, and Ayrshire and Arran at stage 3. Lothian are at stage 4 for specific issues related to the Royal Hospital for Children and Young People, and at stage 3 on performance. As those board mobilisation plans are returned to us by the end of this month and we review those, then we will review the position in terms of where boards are on the escalation framework.
Donald Cameron.
Thank you for that. I think NHS Highland has described that the changes that have been put in place through the team that has supported them, they described those changes as transformational. How are you ensuring that lessons learned from those kind of experiences are applied more widely in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
I'm sure Mr. McCallum will want to say a bit more about this, but of course it's worth remembering that our board directors of finance meet regularly, and that is an area where they can exchange those experiences. Mr. McCallum touched on earlier the peer-to-peer review that boards had undertaken on that kind of regional basis in terms of their COVID costs. So our boards are increasingly looking to share best practice and good experience in these areas. And that includes taking on board the lessons and the experience of NHS Highland. But there will be other routes by which this is shared, and Mr. McCallum may want to pick up on one or two.
Richard McCallum.
Yeah, I think it is a really important point, and I think there has been some significant changes and developments in Highland through the work that they've done through their programme management office, and I would say as well NHS Tayside have also taken a similar approach as well. I mean, there were specific challenges for Highland, for Tayside and those other boards in financial escalation, so I think it's important to recognise that. And the financial challenges were clearly particularly acute for them. But I think there is wider learning, and certainly I don't think it requires the level of support that the NHS Highland have had to implement some of the changes. And as the Cabinet Secretary has said, we have regular forums for sharing this information. NHS Highland themselves have updated the NHS Planning Group and the Directors of Finance Group on that. And even last Friday, the work that's happened in Highland was shared with Directors of Finance for some of those kind of key things that the board has done, the board has undertaken. So I see actually in government, myself and my team have a key role in this to make sure that sharing happens as well as across boards. But that's something that we are absolutely focused on. Obviously, we need to get that balance right. There is the immediate focus on the pandemic and responding to that. But as I think we touched on last week, we will need to consider the financial sustainability very quickly and the impacts that there are on boards. And that's something that we're now focused on and taking forward over the next few months.
Donald Cameron.
Thank you very much for that. That's very reassuring to hear. My final question is a more general one, and it's to ask whether you believe that there is a case for earlier intervention to provide financial support to boards before they are in what might be termed the crisis, financial crisis. Is that something that you would consider, and will that cost more?
Cabinet Secretary.
So I think it's a very good question. I think it is already underway. Mr. McCallum and his team are in regular discussion with boards during the pandemic, but in normal course as well, around their financial performance, as indeed the Chief Operating Officer of the NHS and the Chief Exec of the NHS are in regular discussion with Chief Execs about performance and their overall performance in delivering against what they have set out and what we have agreed should be their plans, their operating plans for any 1 year. So that work is underway, and those interventions are, because of those regular discussions, then warning signals can be spotted, and the intervention by Mr. McCallum and his team can be undertaken and is undertaken. Of course, there is a responsibility that sits with the board of a health board, chair of that board, and their own audit committee and so on, to ensure that they are closely monitoring financial performance as well as the other performance matrices that exist, and that they are highlighting to us. So the chair has a responsibility to highlight directly to me as a cabinet secretary where they have concerns over performance in any regard. Prior to the pandemic, I made a habit. We still have regular discussions. I think every 6 weeks we have a meeting between NHS board chairs and myself and senior government officials throughout the pandemic. But prior to the pandemic, in advance of those meetings, I would meet two or three chairs individually to talk about specific issues in and around their board that we wanted to get their understanding of, and to see if there were specific ways that we could provide support to them. Those could have been staffing issues, it could be finance, it could be performance, whatever. So that continues, and I would anticipate it will continue once we are through the pandemic. In the meantime, we have those regular meetings, and at the moment, the Chief Operating Officer of the NHS, John Conaghan, meets with chief execs at least once every fortnight, but is in daily discussion with some or all of them throughout the time.
Thank you very much. I now call George Adam.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. You'll be aware, Cabinet Secretary, that most of my questions have been about the integration agenda and the integrated authorities, and I was wondering, there's always been some pressure with regards to the budgets, with regards to the integrated authorities, and I just wanted to ask that what progress has been made in ensuring that integrated authorities deliver on the statutory requirement to report budgets against outcomes, and when will this be available?
Cabinet Secretary.
So we have committed to publishing information on the 21-22 budgets by local authorities, and we'll do that. It is in some measure determined, the timing of that is in some measure determined by local governance timetables, of course, and particularly local authority timetables. But as soon as it is possible to do that, then we will publish that information.
Thank you very much. George Adam.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, when we do get to that stage, I'm probably asking you something, almost asking you to, as if you've got a crystal ball there, but are we confident we'll be able to achieve the desired change when we do get this published?
Cabinet Secretary.
Maybe Mr. Adam could help me by being clearer about what change it is he's wanting to see.
I was just following up, Cabinet Secretary, in my first question on the fact that the requirement, the statutory requirements, the reports, budgets against outcomes, you know, will when we do get there, will that make the desired change?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, I anticipate it will. Certainly the integration authorities and the chief officers have not raised any direct concerns with me at all or with any of my officials about their capacity to do that. Obviously, they too, like other parts of the system, are hard pressed at the moment as they have a major role. They are playing a major role in the vaccination programme, of course. So they, and in additional demands in terms of social care, but they have not raised any concerns to indicate that they will not be able to do that.
George Adam.
Okay, thank you, Convener. One final question, Cabinet Secretary. This committee has obviously done a lot of work on social prescribing and can see it as a way forward, and I know the government believes that as well. So my question would be, what measures should be taken within integrated authorities and their budgets in order to try and have this change in this idea of using social prescribing as a way forward?
Cabinet Secretary.
So we share the committee's commitment to and enthusiasm for social prescribing. We expect the integration authorities to be clear in terms of our programme for government. We reiterated that commitment, and we've got a short life working group examining social prescribing to identify the specific ways in which integration authorities can share best practice and undertake this. We expect them to reflect that in the allocation of their resources as they set their budgets for 21-22.
Thank you very much. I now call on Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and good morning to you, Richard, as well. I've got a couple of questions about mental health spending in the budget. I note, Cabinet Secretary, that there's an increase of 22.1 million across the government for funding in mental health services. So that's up 18.9%. And our documents are saying that it's 139.2 million now for mental health. So can you tell me, Cabinet Secretary, what you think the estimate expenditure will be for mental health during this parliamentary term? And I know that pandemic planning and mental health will also be part of that as well.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, so between 2016 and 2017 and 2020 and 21, so far, the total amount spent on mental health services has been over $5 billion. The spending increased between 2017-18 and 2018-19 by 5.2%. And there is significant additional funding has gone in to support additional mental health services for the wider population, some specific mental health and wellbeing services for our adult social care and health workforce, all of that as a consequence of the pandemic, all of which we expect to need to continue throughout the coming financial year. And of course, as a member will know, my colleague Ms. Hawkey published the Mental Health Transition and Recovery Plan as a response to the impacts of COVID-19. And so further funding is part of those COVID consequentials that we spoke about earlier. Some of the additional funding as we go forward will be looking at addressing psychological therapies and CAMHS as well. And more of the detail of that will be set out by Ms. Hawkey in the weeks ahead.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. On the back of George Adams' questions about integration authorities' budgets, this committee has noted previously that it was challenging sometimes to get comprehensive information on spending by individual integration authorities on specific priority areas. Can the Cabinet Secretary help us, I guess, provide an update on how the mental health expenditure by integrated authorities will be presented so that we can analyse how they're achieving their goals and outcomes.
So I think that that partly relates back to the question that Mr. Adam asked, which is the publication of those budgets against outcomes. And as I said before, we will do everything we can working with the integration authorities to ensure that information is published. There is an impact on local governance timetables, as I indicated, but nonetheless, that is our intent to be able to do that as soon as possible.
Emma Harper.
Okay. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just a final question then, that we want obviously to be able to assess the effectiveness of mental health spend. So I'm assuming that will be an ongoing process for a next parliamentary session, even towards the end of this one, but it would continue in the future.
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, absolutely, it will. The member will be very well aware about all the different areas where resourcing has gone into mental health, and obviously some of that resourcing, it has not been possible to see in totality the impact of that. I'm thinking, for example, of the preventative spend in terms of school counselling and counselling in further and higher education. Obviously, we've not seen the full impact of that spend because of the response to the pandemic and lockdown measures, meaning that schools and further and higher education have been disrupted. But nonetheless, there has been possible for some of that work to be seen through some of the support given through Young Scot to children and young people in terms of mental health and wellbeing, the extension of distress brief intervention, the clear your head work, using different delivery channels, if you like, as we go through into the next financial year and the next government. And I very sincerely hope we see ourselves work our way through this pandemic to something that is closer to normal working in education, higher education, and indeed in health and social care, then we will be able to see greater impact more easily from some of that spend. But of course, it will be for a future government to consider whether or not the particular areas of spend remain the right ones in addressing the assessment of the population's wider needs, both children and adults, as a consequence of the pandemic. And we know that that has had a significant impact on people's mental health and wellbeing, different from the way that we respond to issues of crisis, for example, or to psychiatric ill health.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. It's just a reminder, I am one of the co-conveners of the Mental Health Cross-Party Group. I probably should have said that at the beginning, but I do appreciate all the work and welcome all the interventions that have been put forward during the pandemic. So thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And that's me. I'm done. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. I now call Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to the Cabinet Secretary and to Mr. McCallum. I think my line of question really is around alcohol and drug services, which I think is very much linked to Emma Harper's questions around mental health. And I think the way in which alcohol and drug services and the budget and the budget for mental health are aligned, I think is going to be crucial to tackling some of the issues we currently have. And I think, as you know, Cabinet Secretary, the committee has expressed concerns previously over the reduction in budget for alcohol and drug partnerships. And much as with mental health spending, though, the ADPs will be accountable by individual ADPs, making it actually quite difficult to track the overall spending. But we do recognise the Scottish Government have increased that budget by £50 million from 21 to 22. And we also note that since 2008, the Scottish Government has invested the best part of £1 billion to tackle problem drug and alcohol abuse. But we also acknowledge, and the Scottish Government acknowledges, that the drug-related deaths in Scotland is far too high. So if I start with that question, given that there's an investment of over £1 billion in alcohol and drug abuse since 2008, why has so little progress been made to tackle this in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
An entirely fair question, if I may say so. Just before I answer it, can I just make a note for the committee's benefit in responding to Ms Harper? What I've omitted to mention was the Mental Health Research Advisory Group, which we set up at the very early stages of the pandemic to look at emerging research to guide our policy and also to look at the impact of the measures we were taking and their effectiveness. So they will play into an assessment of effectiveness in terms of mental health and outcomes. And actually, that does take me in part to answer Mr. Whittle's question. And this is a complex and challenging issue. And I don't say that as a way of deflecting from what is a perfectly reasonable question. I know that he understands that. I think that the overall assessment would be that we have not sufficiently recognised the interplay between drug, alcohol and mental health issues and not sufficiently looked to provide a more holistic response. I think it has also been clear that there has been progress made, but it has been insufficient at this point, as has been acknowledged. I think we also recognise that the delivery of support and services needs to change in order to be that person-centred service that we look all the time to see in healthcare, and that Derek Feely's report on adult social care emphasises considerably. And all of that is the area that Ms Constance is now focused on, working with those who have direct experience as individuals or as family members, as well as the organisations and agencies, both in the public and the third sector, who deliver support, to find a better way to use that resource, get the outcomes that they seek and that we seek too. And I'm absolutely certain that Ms Constance would be very happy to update the committee on the work that she has undertaken and the work that she plans.
Thank you very much. Brian Whittle.
Thank you, Gavina. As I said in my opening gambit there, I think much of the spending on ADPs will be accounted for by individual ADPs, making it that difficult to track the spending. So can I ask, how is the effectiveness of this additional spend on alcohol and drug services being assessed? How can the effectiveness of spending in this area be improved? And I'm thinking specifically, Cabinet Secretary here, of the third sector and access, the third sector accessing this additional spend, because my concern would be that the ADPs will act as a block, if you like, or a wall to that money cascading down to those frontline third sector organisations that are doing such a great job currently with you know, some of the problem areas in our society.
Cabinet Secretary.
Thanks very much. And I understand that. And in some ways, what we're looking at here in terms of how do you track the money spent into securing or not the results that you spent the money to achieve is not dissimilar to some of the issues we've grappled with, this committee and myself, in terms of integration authorities, being able to see, well, where does the money go and what difference does it make? And again, is an incomplete answer for Mr. Whittle and for the committee, but that is part of what Ms. Constance is actively looking at, is how do we make sure that the resource, which is considerable, but is rightly directed in this way, how do we make sure that that resource gets to the people who need the support via the quickest and easiest route and doesn't get blocked at any point along its way, either always unintentionally, but often through systems and processes. The other part of that, though, is to look is for us to look not only at drug money and mental health money and work on homelessness, but to see that the individual should be at the centre of this. Therefore, what are the support services that should wrap around them and how do we fund those? And the outcome that you're looking for is that that individual is supported to live the life that they want to live, free of addiction and not at risk of drug death or suicide. All of these things come together. There is a lot of work going on inside government at the moment about how do we remove some of the blockages to that joint working, and how do we get, with proper governance, because it is public money that we are looking at, but how do we get that more directly to those individuals and have the services work around the individual, as opposed to trying unintentionally, but in reality, to have the individual reshape themselves fit into the service.
Ryan Whittle.
Thank you. Yeah, I just wanted to get that on the record, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you for that answer. I think the integration of statutory services with the third sector, we have an opportunity here with this investment to do that, as well as you've alluded to, integrating across the across portfolio finance. But my final question, convener, if I may, is just when will we get an update or updated information on that expenditure on alcohol and drug services by the integration authorities, and how we'll be able to measure that against the outcomes that we want?
Cabinet Secretary.
So, in part, my answer is, as I've given it before, and that we will be working, we are working with integration authorities to ensure that that information is published as soon as it possibly can be, bearing in mind, as I've said already, those local governance timetables. But equally, I'm sure Ms Constance would be happy to write to the committee detailing some of the work that she has underway right now, before Parliament rises, but also the future plans that she is putting in place should for a new government and a new Parliament. The one point I also failed again to mention, but I know Mr Whittle will have seen this, is in the Feely report, he pays quite a lot of attention to a much wider perspective of adult social care needs than perhaps we traditionally think of it, much, much beyond care homes, for example, and elderly care, important though that is, and beyond older citizens too, but looking at all adults who have social care needs that should be supported and responded to throughout their lifetime, if that is the duration of it, but should be capable of flexing itself to meet their either their continued progress or their increased frailty.
Thank you. I call David Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I have two questions on sport. And if the Convener allows, I've got two very quick questions on finance. So the first issue on sport is, like the Cabinet Secretary, I'm very concerned about levels of obesity in Scotland. Very concerned as chair of the cross-party group on diabetes, on the increase in type 2 diabetes and its effect on health inequalities. So how is your increased budget for sport being directed to increase levels of physical activity?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the additional investment in Sport Scotland to support Active Scotland has a number of key outcomes, which include encouraging physical activity, developing physical confidence at the earliest age, improving active infrastructure, supporting well-being and resilience through physical activity, and improving opportunities to participate, progress and achieve in sport. A great deal of focus from Sport Scotland on encouraging people to see more and more inexpensive opportunities for activity. A lot of that has featured in some of the mental health and well-being work that has been undertaken during the pandemic, so that we can encourage young people from an early age to be physically active, but to maintain that, even if the activity that they are engaged in changes as they go into their teens and into their older years, whilst at the same time encouraging progression and participation in sport. So those are the outcomes that Sport Scotland have been tasked with. In addition, the Active Healthy Lives funding is increased by 2 million, so 15% next year, and is driven by additional investment in childhood obesity, using it to support our delivery of our intent to have childhood obesity halved by 2030.
David Stewart.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. More an observation than the question, Cabinet Secretary. That's all very valid information. My concern, though, is how are we going to tackle disadvantaged areas? Because these are the areas that are really toiling in terms of obesity and horrendous rates of type 2 diabetes.
Cabinet Secretary.
It's a very good question. The member will recall that in the programme for government, we promoted, if you like, two big thematic headings under which a range of activity was set out. One of those was population health, and I've talked about this before, about looking at why it is that our work on population health is still not cutting through into those areas where people have, as Mr. Stewart says, high levels of obesity, high levels of type 2 diabetes, but want as much as any of us to live more healthily and want that for their children. And so the work that is underway in terms of population health is actually starting with those individuals to talk to them, to have them tell us what are the obstacles in your way. It's not that you don't care about your own physical well-being and you don't care about your children. You do as much as anybody else does. So what is it that is preventing you and how can we help remove those obstacles? So that work is underway and I think will inform a more targeted approach to some of the active healthy living work, for example, and also to the discussions with Sport Scotland.
David Stewart.
And to continue in my final question on sport before I move to my two quick questions, finance. How do you balance funding for elite sports on one hand and grassroots sports on the other? And I make it clear, I'm not suggesting they're in competition, but there is obviously financial decisions to be made about the funding for each.
Cabinet Secretary.
So to a degree, they are in competition because the pot is finite. And so you have to balance the two. It is a difficult set of decisions to make. I think in terms of the overall health of the population of Scotland in the longer term, then the balance should always favour activity that targets precisely the area that Mr. Stewart's earlier question was touching on in terms of area of disadvantage, where we need to find better ways to help people achieve what they want to achieve, which is actually to live more healthily and to have better long-term health, whilst not ignoring the importance of elite sport to the individuals engaged in it, but also to Scotland's wider place in the world, the economic gain that can bring us through large-scale events and so on, tourism and the wider economy. So I don't have an easy answer for you, Mr. Stewart, at all. There isn't an algorithm that allows us to do it. We just have to make the best decisions we can, trying to balance those competing pressures, bearing in mind that there are, of course, other sources of financial support for many of the elite sports.
David Stewart.
If I just move back to finance, Cabinet Secretary, and apologies for not asking you these questions earlier on, you'll know that the committee's pre-budget report highlighted concerns about delays in COVID payments reaching social care providers. Is the Cabinet Secretary confident that the new guidance issued in December will resolve these issues?
Cabinet Secretary.
Yeah, so Mr. McCallum may want to say a bit more about this. Part of the difficulty that we had in issuing the funding that was there and was clearly there to social care providers was the absence of information from them. So it was difficult to know what additional financial pressures they were experiencing that we could support them with if we don't get the information from them. I know that Mr. McCallum and his colleagues have done a great deal of work to ensure that is as streamlined an exercise as it possibly can be. and in the hope that that does secure a swifter response from social care providers themselves so that we can disperse the money. But he may want to say a bit more about that.
Richard McCallum.
I mean, the brief answer is yes, it has made a difference. I think that it probably took a bit of time for providers to familiarise themselves with the approach and the process. And the Cabinet Secretary has said it did take a bit of time to get that information. What we've had to balance is obviously a clear need to provide support with making sure that there's a kind of robust governance and value for money process included within that. So I think as we've progressed over the last number of weeks, we've got to a much better place on that. And I think to answer the question directly, yes, since December that has made a difference.
David Stewart.
Thank you, Convener. I think actually Mr. McCallum's just covered my last point, which is around governance. So I'll move a hand back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much. And I call Emma Harper.
Thank you, Convener, again. Just one question on Food Standards Scotland and the increase in financial input in the budget for Food Standards Scotland. We know that FSS is the central regulatory body for food and feed regulation, and we know that there's been a massive impact of Brexit on the fishing industry recently, and that Food Standards Scotland had to step in and support this massive negative impact on our fishing businesses. So I'm interested, Cabinet Secretary, just in a wee bit more detail about Food Standards Scotland, and do you think that the Scottish Government expect that an increase in Food Standards Scotland's budget will be adequate to allow it to manage the consequences of the UK's departure from the EU and the new arrangements of the EU and the UK's relationship? I'm just hoping that because of what we've seen recently with the fishing industry, that that will be enough to support Food Standards Scotland as we move forward.
Cabinet Secretary.
So we do believe it is adequate, but we have also agreed to revisit it during 21-22 as part of the formal arrangements that we have with Food Standards Scotland, to make sure that our current expectation, which is that the additional funding or the total funding is adequate, remains the case. And that seems to me a very sensible proposition from all of us to take forward, given that the play out of the Brexit outcomes and the current deal has some way to go. And with every day, we do see additional impositions on business and additional costs.
Thank you very much. I now call on David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, Cabinet Secretary and Mr. McCallum. How does the National Performance Framework fit with other performance frameworks in place for health, local development plans, standards and integration health and wellbeing outcomes, which has a greater prominence in influencing spending decisions in the budget?
Cabinet Secretary.
So the National Performance Framework indicators, particularly in relation to health, are closely aligned to the wider targets in health. So in terms of spending and spending decisions around the budget, then those are made against the overall objectives of the health portfolio, and those align with the National Performance Framework.
David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. Has evidence and information in the National Performance Framework caused you to make any specific changes to your budget plans?
Cabinet Secretary.
So it has supported our consideration on areas like mental wellbeing, physical activity and healthy weight. And we've covered some of that earlier in response to Mr. Stewart's question. So the alignment of the two areas and the crossover of them are an important part of the consideration we give about how we will take policy forward, particularly in relation to health inequalities.
David Torrance.
And my final question, Convener. The Equality and Fairer Scotland statement that accompanied the budget outlines areas in which health spending is intended to tackle inequalities. How is spending, both new and existing, evaluated in respect of its impact on inequalities?
Cabinet Secretary.
So that's a key focus of our health analytical services, and there's information on that, I think, set out in the Equality Budget Statement. But that is the work that our analytical colleagues undertake, is to look at how we are allocating our resources and whether the outcomes impact positively in terms of reducing health inequality.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And just going back to David Torrance's questions around the National Performance Framework, is there any conclusion that you would reach in relation to resources required to deliver improved outcomes in health? Is there a need for additional resources, or does the National Performance Framework allow you to make decisions about spending resources differently? Cabinet Secretary.
So I think the National Performance Framework does allow that to happen. In terms of additional resources, of course, the planned budget for health for the next financial year at $16 billion is considerable. It is always possible to spend more on health and social care, and it won't have escaped members' notice that the Feely report and recommendations come with a considerable additional investment requirement, of which, of course, is for a future government to determine, and Parliament, future government and Parliament to determine.
Indeed, and that is for another day. But thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, for that second and comprehensive evidence session, and thank you also to Mr. McCallum for your evidence too. That concludes this evidence session and concludes the public part of this meeting. We will resume in a few minutes on a different platform, but for the moment I suspend this meeting.